The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Yay! We love Fridays because we get to wrap up the week with Marcy Wheeler of EmptyWheel.net. And it's the beginning of the weekend. And, well, we get to put a week that feels like another few years behind us. This was an eventful week. I think was this press conference just yesterday? Donald Trump had a press conference at Mar-a-Lago. By the way, you know, for some
basement
in his basement, and for someone who bitched so much about the audio at the National Association of Black Journalists thing that he went to the previous week, did you notice he had it set up so you couldn't even hear the journalists? The reporters in the room asking the questions. I mean, the whole thing was just a mess.
Right. You couldn't hear the questions and he couldn't hear them, or he feigned not being able to hear them. And one of the reasons I keep calling for him to release his medical reports is because that kind of a gunshot right next to your ear, like he suffered, can have effects, can have lasting effects on your hearing. And in fact, Dr. Candyman, Johnson Jackson, even in one of his propaganda reports said, oh, he's going to have some follow-up hearing tests. And I think, you know, we should know, particularly given the focus on whether, Joe Biden is competent to be president, we should know whether Donald Trump's hearing has been affected.
Well, absolutely. But we've still never gotten a real medical report on him.
No, we haven't.
We still have never gotten any tax returns from him also, just throwing that out there. Because
the
media,
ones that got stolen, yeah.
Right. The media doesn't seem to ask about it anymore.
That's the point. If you're going to go into his basement and have the opportunity to ask questions with him on screen, ask the questions, ask the very basic transparency questions. Don't tee up questions where he can suggest that Kamala Harris is disrespecting her Indian or her Black identity because he says so, right?
Right.
Like, don't allow him to use you as props, which is what really the press has become anytime they get around Donald Trump anymore.
Right. It is astounding. They just are completely derelict in their responsibility. It's shocking, frankly. It's really depressing and shocking. I'm glancing over here because, oh, there it is. Okay, I wanna play some video to start because I'd be remiss if we didn't note the date. Today is August 9th, 2024. 50 years ago today. Hold on, I just wanna make sure we don't feedback audio. I got to get all the settings correct. There we go. Okay. So this happened 50 years ago today.
To fight through the months ahead for my personal vindication would almost totally absorb the time and attention of both the president and the Congress in a period when our entire focus should be on the great issues of peace abroad and prosperity without inflation at home. Therefore, I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
Wow.
Vice President Ford will be sworn in as president at that hour in this office.
So I don't think we'd ever see anything like that happening again. We don't have leaders, at least on the Republican side, who take the hint, but Nixon had to resign or he would have been impeached.
Republican members of Congress who are willing to do their job.
There's that, because, well, what we saw, I mean, I think the crimes that Donald Trump committed, and many of them haven't been tried yet, and we'll get to that because there's action, pale. I mean, Nixon's crimes pale in comparison to what Trump has done. However, that his party, Nixon's party, told him, you better leave or you will be impeached. You will be removed from office. That won't happen today.
Well, yeah, correct. With Donald Trump, you know, he over the course, I mean, this is not to toot my own horn, but this is the point of the podcast that LOL GOP and I are doing. Over the course of his presidency, Donald Trump trained Republicans to value him over rule of law. And eventually they all either quit or fell in behind him. And so they are, you know, they're still trying to bend the law to protect him going forward. And it's shameful stuff. But, you know, if Vice President Harris does win the election by any kind of margin at all, they're going to be tainted as a brand. I think Republicans might finally be at that point where all of their coddling of a wannabe dictator may start to have larger repercussions for their party.
Do you see any indication, though, that they're headed in that direction? Because I keep waiting for somebody. And aside from like the mayor of Mesa, Arizona, I'm not seeing a whole lot of Republicans step up and say, you know what? You just can't vote for this guy. He's not worthy. He's not fit for the office.
Yeah, it's early yet, right? So Kamala Harris has been in the race for 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
I think. We'll talk about their attempt to swift vote Tim Walz.
Yes.
And one of the reasons they're doing that, I think, is because he's so obviously appealable to I've seen people describe that he provides a model for masculinity that, you know, that people used to cherish, the dad, like the Midwestern dad. I have a friend who was raised in St. Paul whose dad is a absolute dead ringer for Tim Walz. And, you know, I just, every time I see him and they make jokes about like the jumper cables in their car, I'm like, yeah, right. You know, like that woman's dad trained her always to have jumper cables in her car. And every time we would need jumper cables, we'd be like, hey, Katie, where are the jumper cables? Cause we knew that her dad had raised her the same way Tim Walz raises his kids. And, you know, I think that there is this effort and it's working, but it's not working as well as the original swift vote did to undercut Tim Walz's broad based appeal. We'll see what happens going forward. I mean, and the contrast, like, I don't think Harris picked him for the contrast with J.D. Vance, who claims to be the child of the Midwest, but comes off as this, you know, incel, as this far right nut job. But that contrast may actually grow because Donald Trump is sitting on his ass in Mar-a-Lago and sending J.D. Vance out to kind of stalk Kamala Harris.
Oh my God.
And you know, it was interesting because they launched the swift boat 2 days ago in Michigan. And by yesterday, I mean, granted, I watched all the Michigan events because I'm from Michigan.
Yes,
and it, like, it's one of the first times I was like, damn, I want to be back. I mean, Michigan's politics have been great since I left, right?
Yeah.
Like, Big Gretch is amazing. Like, the whole executive, Dana
Nessel. Yeah, it's all women, first of all, and they're great.
The whole top to bottom in Michigan is superb. In Michigan, you know, Democrats got a majority. It's just so fun to watch. But that I watched both the, I'm wandering today, but people will have to get over it. I watched both the plane hangar event at DTW at the Detroit airport. And also
the UAW?
The UAW event at like a historic Wayne County UAW location. I've been to meetings there.
Wow.
And I remember I've been to meetings there with John Dingell, right?
Uh-huh.
With Debbie Dingell's
sure.
spouse. Mm-hmm. And it is such and at least when I was there, it's such an instrumental part of doing Democratic politics in Southeastern Michigan, that those UAW locations, because they're the obvious locations. And I remembered back to 2016, there were gripes in 2016 and, you know, Hillary offered excuses for it, but there were gripes in 2016 that Hillary had to cancel the one event she had scheduled in Wisconsin. And while she did an event or two in Michigan, She never once went to a UAW facility. And you know, I was aghast by that. I was like, how is it that you don't go to a UAW facility? Right. That's not possible. You don't, like, it's just something you do as a Democrat. And so it was so heartwarming, really, to see Tim Walz and Kamala Harris with Sean Fain in that, because Sean Fain also spoke at the airport event. But here it was just a smaller UAW event, and it was a tribute. And both of them, I mean, Tim Walz, I don't know whether he's still an AFT member, but he was an AFT member. He was a union member when he was a teacher. And just both of them, but especially Tim Walz, speaking about unions as this instrumental part of creating the middle class. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Joe Biden has done such a good job with labor, such a good job supporting labor. Sean Fain mentioned that both of them, Tim Walz, you know, before he even, well, now we, there is a story that says he was kind of saying, you know, there might be this opportunity, but Tim Walz, before he was a candidate to be vice president, also was walking picket lines with the UAW. And it's an important culture in the Twin Cities as well. So that event is not at all glamorous, but that event was very heartwarming for me as a Michigander, because it's the kind of nuts and bolts you do, right? Mm-hmm. It's the kind of nuts and bolts you do to ensure that the get out the vote in November will be successful. I mean, that's one of the first things I learned when I was doing politics in southeastern Michigan. That has changed, because the UAW had kind of a period in the wilderness with the financial crunch, and then they have had this resurgence under Sean Fain. And so it was just one of the details that Kamala is doing right.
Yep.
Not to say that Biden wouldn't do that right. He certainly would have reached out to the UAW. But the Kamala and Tim Walz show, you know, it's just, it's really cool to watch. But the airport hangar was, and this sets up the disastrous press conference yesterday.
Yes.
The optics of the airport hangar were such that, because, right, so you've got the side of the auditorium, basically, not the front or back, open.
Right.
They had the auditorium to the side so that you literally watched Air Force Two roll up and Kamala Harris and Tim Walz get off the plane. And that iconography is the stuff that Trump and his supporters really get the rocks off of.
Right.
I mean, like, really, you, like, part of the January 6th investigation tracked how Trump would show off for his supporters, would fly by in Air Force One or fly by in Marine Force One or drive by in his limo. And so this was precisely the iconography that Trump aims for. It was a huge crowd. And I'm sure that it just really got in Trump's head, because I'm working on a post right now that shows that 6 minutes of his press conference, Trump lied about crowd size.
Oh, God.
Six
yes,
minutes
he did.
Of his press conference, Trump lied about polling. And another 6 minutes, he lied about being a victim. And so that's right there. 18 minutes out of an hour press conference.
Right. And it was filled with lies. I'm trying feverishly to pull up a picture of the hangar, because it was quite impressive. Let me see if I can't. It's small, but here's what I got. So you can see, it was astounding. The pictures were great. And speaking of Harris Walz rallies, I'm going to one today. So they're going to be here in Phoenix this afternoon. So this show will run as usual. I'll set it up to do a premiere on YouTube. So at 2 o'clock Pacific, 5 o'clock Eastern, it'll just fire Progressive Voices. We'll have the audio. I don't have to be here, so I won't screw it up. So it'll run as it's supposed to without my hand on it. I pulled some clips from this thing yesterday. And before I get to it, I do, you know, the news of Tim Walz broke during this past week. So when we last spoke Friday, we're like, well, we'll know by Tuesday. And indeed, we found out Tuesday morning. It was apparently Kamala didn't make the final decision till Tuesday morning, if we believe that. One of the fun stories is Tim Walz didn't pick up the phone right away because the number that she was calling from was blocked. So there was no caller ID, so he didn't take it. So anyway, they did it. He's in. And you were ecstatic. Yes, this was your choice?
Yeah, I mean, I would have been happy with many of the choice. Mm-hmm. I would have been happy with any of the choice, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, they were
but
all good.
I just think that Tim Walz has really enthused people. Dana Houle, for people who know him, who used to do a lot of campaign management and was worked in DC for a little while as well. He described that here you have a 60-year-old whose job is to attract the youth, which is Kamala, mm-hmm. and another 60-year-old whose job is to attract old white guys, right. who is Tim Walz. And they're both 60.
I know.
And
they they're do, 6 months
like,
apart.
This notion that you know, they're playing on their middle class upbringing, which is right, mm-hmm, right. Mm-hmm. But it is remarkable because Kamala was going to fight this notion that she's a San Francisco liberal, and now you've got a guy from Nebraska,
right?
One of the accounts of the selection described that Jane Klebe, who is the chair of the Nebraska Democratic Party, she's really wonderful. I've met her at Netroots Nation over the years, mm-hmm. and really smart, right? Like, but she's got a ranch or something in Nebraska, and she like a number of other people were like, you really got to check out Tim Walz. She knew him as a Nebraska native, and one of the things that their story does. There's two things that their story does that are really, really important. And one of the things that their story does is it argues, it shows every time they get on the stage together and talk about how, you know, they're both middle class and some of the things they did as middle class people are common. And by the way, like Joe Biden, he didn't go to an Ivy League school,
right.
and he's always talked about that. Mm-hmm. And this continues that, right? This is another continuation of, I mean, I complain a lot that people haven't done a profile of Howard University because Howard University really is the Ivy League school of the history of Black colleges.
Right.
But so important to American history. But nevertheless, yes. these are not Ivy League schools, and these are people who worked their way up. These are people who, you know, just as they said, Kamala worked in a McDonald's. They did not come from the privilege that Donald Trump came from, and so they are talking about the commonality of American life between urban areas and rural areas. Mm. Now, Steve Kornacki has decided that Walz is not going to have that much of an effect in rural areas. I hope that one of the things David Plouffe will do, he's been brought on yes. to the campaign,
yep.
is replicate a little of what Obama did. And what, by the way, Slotkin is trying to do, the Democratic
Alyssa
candidate.
Slotkin, running
senator, yep,
right, Michigan.
In Michigan, who got stage time with Kamala Harris and Tim Walz. Mm-hmm. And they're not trying to win rural areas. They're just trying to expand their vote in rural areas. That's what Obama did really well. And I think with this ticket, you can do that really well. You can say there's a commonality to middle-class life, whether you're from an urban area or from, you know, a farm in Nebraska. And we're going to talk about that common American way of life. Sure, most people in rural areas aren't going to buy that, but some will, mm-hmm. right? Some will at least think differently about neighbor. About
right.
their neighbors.
Right.
I mean, that's
right.
what Walz uses all the time. I keep remembering, this is weird. I shouldn't think about this, but it's weird. Like my grandfather grew up on a homestead in Kansas, in northern Kansas, right? Close to the border, really close to the border of Nebraska. And I went there when I was 9. And then in 2019, when my brother and I drove my mom's ashes from Philadelphia to Arizona, where my father's buried. Mm-hmm. And along the way, we just kind of, without any planning, we turned to each other. We were in Nebraska going west on 80, and we're like, let's go to the homestead. So we got off the road, drove like 70 miles on dirt roads, wow, middle of nowhere, and rolled up, found the farm. They live on a, they have, it's a homestead. They have a cow farm. And met cousins we had never before met, wow, because they were the, they were gone when we visited when we were nine and 12. And those people were Bill O'Reilly fans. I mean, like I was desperately hiding my political leanings the entire time we were sitting there drinking sweet tea uh-huh, on the porch in Kansas. But, but you know, I think about that. I think about like, that's my family. And you know, if you can replicate this notion of commonality, even a little bit,
yes,
that will start to chip away at some of what has been lost in America in recent years. Now, the other thing that I think is even more important, and one of the things in the Midwest that we saw, and you might see today, mm-hmm, I suspect you'll see today, but like, you know, in Philadelphia and in Philly, you had Josh Shapiro.
That's right.
Everyone's like, dude was able to build a road in 2 weeks, right? Yep. And then you went to Wisconsin and everyone talked about Tony Evers.
Yep.
And then you went back to Michigan and you had Big Gretch.
Right.
And they all were talking about their relationship with Tim Walz as fellow governors, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they all talked about getting shit done.
That's right.
They all said, we as new Democratic governors in the Rust Belt are focusing on getting shit done. By the way, Gretchen Whitmer also said, because you want to get this clip, also said that Tim Walz is the only governor who swears more than she does. So ooh, they're both, of course, after my own heart.
Because, mine as well.
and they were swearing up a storm at the airplane event.
But, oh, how funny.
But here's the point is one of the, like, for so long, we have the country as a whole has been led to believe that the government isn't there for you, shouldn't mm-hmm, be there for
right,
you. And what we're seeing with these swing states, I mean, Georgia will be the outlier because Georgia doesn't have a Democratic governor, but you know, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Minnesota, Michigan, Arizona, you're going to see, right, and not Nevada, but you're
I'm sure
going
Katie
to see
Hobbs will be there today. So I, you know,
I'm sure she will. Yep. And we're going to have the same kind of story, which is that Democrat, this new brand of Democratic governor has been able to implement policy that actually affects people's lives. Mm-hmm. And this is such a radical, like, you know, getting through the neoliberalism, this is such a radical notion that, that the government can fix roads.
Right.
Can, you know, all of these governors, Tim Walz did a lot of investment of infrastructure. He credited Big Gretch with fixing the damn roads.
Right.
You know, you're telling a story about all of the investment in these swing states that Trump promised and failed to deliver on. And if people begin to believe that government can do something good for them again, that's going to be really radical. I mean, really right, a dramatic change in the way we've been thinking since Reagan.
Since Reagan said, you know, with the government, I'm here to help, you know, that's not a thing. Well, you know, Tim Walz is probably the guy to say, yeah, I'm from the government and we are here to help.
And here are the very specific ways we are helping. I mean, one of the things that hasn't got a lot of attention, but I think is really cool, is Walz eliminated restrictions on certain jobs in Minnesota government to people who have a college degree.
Oh, good.
And you know, it's things like, or the child tax credit, mm-hmm, right? Like the child tax credit. And one of the funniest things about Walz's selection, and then I'll shut up and you can, one of the funniest things about Walz's selection is honestly like people, Democrats from across the spectrum, Trump all came out in super enthusiastic support of him, right?
Yes.
So you had AOC immediately coming out, you had Nancy Pelosi, but the person whose support was most interesting was Manchin.
Yes, Joe Manchin came out and endorsed him. You got AOC to Joe Manchin.
And the Joe Manchin thing is about Tim Walz being this kind of ordinary dad type. It's not mm-hmm, about necessarily the policies that Tim Walz has pressed. It's about the fact that he's an ordinary dad. Right. I think he's a white guy, ordinary dad.
Right.
And that's sort of what Manchin wanted to return the Democratic Party to. And those are all really potentially dramatic things, really potentially just a change in the way we think of our relationship to government and our relationship to each other.
Well, definitely. And he is just, he's refreshing. He is a breath of fresh air. He's like, is he real? He's dad. He's that some of the memes going around social media are hysterical, you know. And I can't think of one off the top of my head, but basically, you know, Donald Trump's the guy, or J.D. Vance is the guy that you want to, you know, the creep guy that you avoid. And Tim Walz is the guy who's going to come over and mow your lawn. I mean, it's
or
a bad
walk you home to avoid
the creep guy. Exactly. So stuff like that. What I found hysterical is in this so-called press conference yesterday, it's hard to call it a presser because it was just such a garbage dump. But when Donald Trump decided to talk about Tim Walz, by the way, there's audio of him from May of 2020, Trump praising Tim Walz for his response to the riots after George Floyd's murder, which of course happened in Minnesota, where he called him a good guy. I've got that. But I want to play this one. This is from the thing yesterday. And listen to, I mean, Trump is so lazy. He didn't even have any specifics that he could point at regarding Tim Walz. He just spoke in very vague generalities without actually saying anything.
She picked a radical left man that is, he's got things done that he has positions that are just not, it's not even possible to believe that they
not
exist.
Not possible to believe.
He's going for things that nobody's ever even heard of. Heavy into the transgender world, heavy into lots of different worlds.
Things that nobody could believe. I mean, there's nothing specific in there. It sounds like he doesn't even know who Tim Walz is. It's generic criticism of some guy who he has no clue about.
Right. And I mean, that reflects how spun free of actual reality most far right commentary is. So it works for Trump's mob. And it worked for these journalists yesterday. None of them said, there was no follow up that said, do you have specific critiques of Tim Walz? Do you know that you commended Tim Walz's response to George Floyd? None of that. Question about, like, do you know that Tim Walz managed a state stimulus and you failed to deliver the stimulus you promised? Do you know? I mean, it's like the Trump has, I'm convinced, you know, like I use the word, and this is not very polite, but I used the word. I kept thinking of goldfish as I was watching that press conference yesterday, because these journalists are just sitting there floating around in Trump's world, and they're not, there's no sign of them setting the agenda, of them setting the terms of their relationship with Trump. And because of that, it's very, very easy for him to manipulate them. They are just really props in his reality TV show. I mean, that's the other thing. I've been thinking about trying to write this up since the NABJ thing is, mm-hmm. like, you know, Trump approaches his relationship with journalists as he does a reality TV show. And so he approaches his relationship with journalists as if they're a contestant in The Apprentice. And but the truly dangerous thing is what we saw yesterday, which is that journalists get invited to Mar-a-Lago. They get opportunities to ask questions on camera that if he refuses to answer, or if he decides to change the subject, which he did for a number of questions yesterday, then at least it's on camera, right? I made a big stink before the press conference. I was like, this is the 2-year anniversary of the search of Mar-a-Lago. Ask him where the remaining documents are. Uh-huh. Ask him where the remaining documents are. And I tried to prep them so that when he falsely claimed I won, when he falsely claimed there was a difference between him and Joe Biden, somebody would say, now, wait a second, if you're, you know, the basis on which your prosecution was dismissed, which is that the appointment of Jack Smith was unconstitutional, then the appointment of Robert Hur was also unconstitutional. Same appointment, same structure, same out of DOJ person. No one's ever, not only are they not going to ask Trump that, they're not going to explain that to readers. And the same thing happened in NABJ. He made false claims about the documents case, and, you know, no one has bothered to correct that record. And so what we saw yesterday is journalists following Trump's rules, mm-hmm. His reality TV show for journalists.
Yeah.
And to a large extent, and there are exceptions, and there are a couple exceptions that really, I mean, people did afterwards immediately start fact checking.
Afterwards,
some people,
right.
With a varying degree of adequacy to the fire hose of lies he told. Journalists in the room did not fact check him. Did not Maggie Haberman had two questions. She didn't even fact check him on the actual question she was asking, which was about pardons, but not, oh, was the pardon in your desk drawer for Roger Stone the one we know about, or was that one for, did it involve Macron? Did it involve the Macron hacking leak? Well, of course, you know, she's not going to ask that question. But, the New York Times, and I'm going to post this while you're at the rally today.
Okay.
The New York Times, they had two stories up about the press conference, one of which is really important by journalists who are not super well known, and one of which was by Maggie and John Swan and Goldmacher or whatever his name is. And that one was terrible. I mean, it just repeated the lies that three journalists just repeated the lies that Donald Trump told to the journalists in the room. I looked at 1 o'clock my time. So, first thing in the morning, your time, or not your time, but East Coast time. And at that point, they had completely memory holed the entire press conference, the whole thing. You couldn't find it on either the digital or their front page. And even still, their digital front page, you can't find an account. Like, the response, if this were Joe Biden, would have been, oh, my God, Joe Biden has to step down. He's the man's incompetent. We can't risk having this guy run the country.
Right.
And there was not only not that, but there was not any report on the press conference at all, including, and this is the story that people should read at the New York Times, but there's a version of it at NBC and a version of it at San Francisco Chronicle. And that is that I don't even know what the question was, but, you know, out of the blue, Donald Trump was like, oh, I totally know Willie Brown.
Okay, hold on.
Willie Brown.
I have that.
You have this.
So let's share it. So this is the Willie Brown segment, which is absolutely astounding. Here we go.
Well, I know Willie Brown very well. In fact, I went down in a helicopter with him. We thought maybe this is the end. We were in a helicopter.
Maybe this is
going to a certain location together. And there was an emergency landing.
Emergency landing.
This was not a pleasant landing.
No,
not a pleasant landing.
He was a little concerned.
Willie
was. I know him pretty well. I
mean,
I haven't seen him in years. But he told me terrible things about her.
He told me terrible things about Kamala Harris.
This is what you're telling me anyway, I guess. But he had a big part in what happened with Kamala, but
Kamala.
I don't know. Maybe he's changed his tune,
Kamala.
But
he used three different pronunciations.
He was not a fan of hers very much at that point.
He was not a fan of hers very much at that point. Well, in case you're wondering what Willie Brown had to say about that.
I know Willie Brown very well. In fact, I went down in a helicopter with him. We thought maybe this is the end.
What, Donald?
It appears that Donald Trump is talking about you today.
That's what I heard. I heard that he was doing what Donald does best.
Which is?
His creativity fictional.
So I could read you directly what he said, but in essence, he says you were doing business together, you were in a helicopter, you almost crashed. Let's start with that.
I've never done business with Donald Trump. Let's start with that.
Start with that.
And secondly, I don't think I'd want to ride on the same helicopter with him.
So you were not in a helicopter with him that almost crashed?
No.
That's your answer, right? Okay.
The laughter is just classic. So that's Willie Brown. No, I think he was talking about Jerry Brown. For those who don't know, that's Jerry Brown on the left. That's Willie Brown on the right. So, no. And
But the even better thing. So yeah. So like he. But even Jerry Brown says, no, we were on a helicopter together, but it didn't go down. Like there was right. no risky. And who else was on the helicopter but Gavin Newsom?
Ooh, okay.
And so the New York Times version of the story, and as I said, NBC and the San Francisco Chronicle both have versions. They're all worth reading. But Gavin Newsom was on the helicopter with Jerry Brown, the white guy, not Willie Brown, the black guy. Right. And he says, we talked about everyone else, but not Kamala Harris. And that's interesting. Because if you talked about everyone else, if Donald Trump talked about everyone else with Gavin Newsom, one person who would be included in that everyone else is Gavin Newsom's former wife, who is now Don Jr.'s virtual wife.
Yeah.
For all intents and purposes.
Kimberly Gargoyle. Right.
Yeah. This helicopter that they flew on was 2018 or 2019 during the California fires. They were reviewing the fire scene. This is when Donald Trump claimed there were too many trees and they were going to rake the fire.
Gotta rake the forest.
So what he's done in his little brain is turned a helicopter flight over something dangerous into a dangerous helicopter flight. But there is a possibility, and I hope people go chase down Gavin Newsom to find out whether this is, I want to know whether they talked about Guilfoyle.
Yeah.
I want to know whether Don Jr.'s daddy was talking to his lady friend's former spouse about what a nut job Guilfoyle is. In which case, then the claim that Willie Brown or even Jerry Brown was saying bad things about Kamala, because Gavin Newsom says they didn't, right?
Yes.
And Jerry Brown says they didn't.
Uh-huh.
So maybe Donald Trump has, in addition to translating white Jerry Brown into a black Willie and the danger of the forest fires into the danger of a helicopter lander, there's a possibility that he has translated Kamala Harris into Kimberly or Kimberly Guilfoyle into Kamala Harris.
You know, like, he's done that. He did that with Nancy Pelosi and Nikki Haley. So we're witnessing, and a lot of media entities pointed out, the ones that did cover this event yesterday, that he is in cognitive decline. And the double standard is just in your face, because the media went after Joe Biden when he'd flub a name or something. And by the way, something Joe Biden has always done. And the things that Donald Trump yesterday, like, for instance, this about the price of oil. Did you hear this one?
You know, they're drilling now because they had to go back because gasoline was going up to $7, $8, $9 a barrel. So they said, we better do what Trump. But the day after the election.
Wait, gasoline was going up to $7, $8, $9 a barrel. Is he talking about oil or is he talking about the price of gas? Either way, the man obviously doesn't have his.
And one thing that's interesting is I've seen analysis that says that what Biden did with the strategic reserve, because basically he did empty it when gasoline at the pump.
Right.
So and that's
pump.
Probably what Trump is talking right. about.
Right. Per gallon, not.
So he
barrel,
did empty it at that time and then he refilled it at a much lower level.
Right.
But by flushing the market like he did, he totally undercut OPEC at a time when OPEC really could have done some damage to the country. So I've read at least one analysis of it that said it was absolutely a brilliant move on the Biden administration's
sure.
part. And Donald Trump is trying to turn it into this problem. The best part, on top of the confusing white Jerry Brown with black Willie Brown, my other favorite part of the presser is that Trump claimed that people can't get bacon anymore.
Oh, I didn't pull that one. Yes. And that the price has exploded, and I've seen charts. It hasn't. It's the price of bacon has been fairly steady over the years. He comes up with these things like, where does he get it? And then, of course,
we have short memories. So a lot of people don't recall, like the first, right after the inauguration, the first thing that we saw, the first interaction between the Trump administration and the media was on, I guess it was a Saturday, and Sean Spicer, who was then the press secretary, comes into the James Brady press briefing room and admonishes the gathered crowd, the gathered reporters, about their reporting on the crowd size at the inaugural. And how dare you say it wasn't big? It's the largest audience for any inaugural ever. And of course, Donald Trump is still obsessed with that and said this
yesterday. Never see the picture of the crowd, the biggest crowd I've ever spoken. I've spoken to the biggest crowds. Nobody's spoken to crowds bigger than me. If you look at Martin Luther King, when he did his speech, his great speech, and you look at ours, same real estate, same everything, same number of people, same. if not, we had more. And they said he had a million people, but I had 25,000 people. But when you look at the exact same picture, and everything's the same because it was the fountains, the whole thing, all the way back to from Lincoln to Washington. And you look at it, and you look at the picture of his crowd, my crowd. We actually had more people.
What?
They said I had 25,000, and he had a million people. And I'm okay with it because I liked Dr. Martin Luther King.
Oh, my God. It's just on every level. It's embarrassing. It's just...
Well, and there's an important other detail of that is in context, he was talking about his January 6th rally.
Yeah.
Which it's also false that he had, I mean, he had, I think, fewer people at the... I mean, he had a ton of people at the January 6th rally, but he had fewer people at the January 6th rally than he did at his inauguration.
Yes.
So even flimsier, but also not the same real estate.
No.
And he, as part of that claim, tried to claim that only a few people moved from, like, not many people. Now he's saying this after he's reviewed criminal discovery. Not many people followed his exhortation to go to the Capitol. And what DOJ has set up, if they ever get the chance to, now I'm see I'm segueing into the that we're back on the January 6th case. What prosecutors have set up through a series of phone records, like what they did early on in the investigation for January 6th was first get what's called a geofence, which is who are the phones that are pinging on cell, or actually they didn't use cell because that's less legal. They used Google and Facebook. Who are the, what are the phones that are pinging on Google or Facebook from with inside the Capitol? And then they expanded it slightly and said, which are the ones just outside the Capitol? Because the most criminal people were the ones assaulting cops trying to get in. And then they said, well, let's talk about the whole area that was fenced off that day, that was restricted that day, just to see who's there. And so they did that in three rows, and there's been some interesting legal cases that I've covered. But in addition to that, they then went back and said, okay, now that we have these phones identified that were at the Capitol, or also the phones from criminal defendants who we identified them when we popped their phones, let's go back and see how many of those phones were at the Ellipse. And when those phones moved to the Capitol. Now, New York Times did this very early on. They showed, I think it was somebody, you could see a simulation of all the phones that were at the Ellipse, listen to Trump, tell them to go to the Capitol, and the ones that broke the law in one way or another by going to the Capitol. And, you know, he's claiming it's not that many people. It's at least 10,000. It's at least, given the numbers that we saw out of the existing geofences, it's at least 10,000. So he's, you know, he's complaining that he's like, oh, only 25,000 people. They said only 25,000 people were at my rally. It's, he's right. It's probably closer to 50,000, right? But that's saying one out of five people listened to his exhortation, at least, to go to the Capitol. I mean, that actually the 10,000 is about half the actual number because of the, of what they were able to geofence. That was the Google number. Anyway. Let's just say, sure, you got 50,000 people at the Ellipse, Dad, but you got 20,000 of those people to go attack the Capitol. That is what prosecutors want to show if this thing ever goes to trial, and they're going to have really cool graphics to do it. And Donald Trump knows that. Donald Trump knows that. So when he said yesterday, oh, not that many people went to the Capitol, he's already seen the geofence analysis to know that that's false.
Wow. But I don't think he has the cognitive ability. I don't think he remembers. Frankly, so much of this presser yesterday sounded like he was just faking it. He was asked about mifepristone. His answer sounded like he had no idea what mifepristone was.
He has no idea what mifepristone is. None.
Here, listen to this.
And so he was
worse
just,
than Biden. Yeah. And she's actually not as smart.
Okay.
Okay. She's actually not
Kamala,
as smart.
But the question's
That's
coming
hard
up
to
here.
Believe, isn't it?
Yeah. Can I have a political question, but I want to ask a follow-up to one of the abortion questions.
Okay.
There are other things the federal government could do, not just a ban. Would you direct your FDA, for example, to revoke access to mifepristone? That's one of the things.
So
that
you could do things that would supplement, absolutely, and those things
would
are pretty open and humane. But you have to be able to have a vote, and all I want to do is give everybody a vote. And the votes are taking place right now as we speak.
That's something you would
but
consider.
But it's a very good. There are many things on a humane basis that you can do outside of that, but you also have to give a vote, and the people are going to have to decide.
What the hell is he talking about?
Well, and here's the thing. I mean, there were actually three questions about abortion in the press conference. And, you know, at one point he said, I'm not going to tell you how I'm going to vote in the Florida referendum.
Right.
At another point, like two other points, he said, well, I don't think abortion is that salient. He didn't use salient because that's too big a word for him.
Yes.
But I don't like, I think
it's not a big deal. People don't care anymore. Basically,
people don't care about abortion. You know, everyone gets to vote. People wanted to vote. You know, people, there are exceptions. Of course, the exceptions don't work. And what was the most important thing to me, right? And there was this moment where Meghan McCain, who, by the way, is taking enormous glee out of the fact that, what's her name? Who's running the Republican running against Gallego?
Carrie Lake.
Carrie Lake. Who's nutballs. She's losing badly.
Yes, like,
there was
is.
A poll that came out by, according to one poll, she's 11 points behind Gallego.
Yeah.
In another poll, she's like 20 points behind him. And so McCain was like, I just taking a lot of glee out of the fact that she's going to lose this and lose badly. But that's an instance where the commitment to Trumpism may do really huge damage to the Republican Party. I mean, once Gallego gets in, he's going to be an incredibly popular senator and an incredibly effective senator. And so her presence in the race makes an attempt to retain the Senate far easier because that takes Arizona off the table.
Right.
But the important takeaway, I think, for me is that either Trump's people are not leveling with him or he's completely deluded about how much the race has changed since Kamala got in. I mean, that's this post that I'm working on. Like, he's lying about the polls. And one of the polls he's relying on is Rasmussen, Josh Marshall from TPM has this thing where he sees the joint polls go up. He always says, Rasmussen is going to have to weigh in with something ridiculous.
Right.
Because what he's following is that that Rasmussen is tweaked so that the combined polls never show Donald Trump losing badly. And it's through like Rasmussen, you know, just makes shit up. So, so Trump yesterday was like, oh, Rasmussen, I'm winning by a ton. And sure enough, there is one Rasmussen poll that is tweaking all the averages, but it's not like if any of the other polls are real, Kamala has a small lead in this, you know, like not in all of the swing states yet. I mean, this is going to be a battle at least for a little while, but Kamala certainly has changed the outlook of the race. That's before Tim Walz got in.
Right.
Right.
Yep.
And including in states like Arizona and Nevada, like both of which look like they might be out of reach. And then we'll find out, you know, I look forward to next week to hearing your story about how things go in the rally today. So he's lying about the polls. He's lying about the import of abortion. I mean, it was always going to be important on this year. And it's going to be important, you know, Florida. And I suspect one of the reasons why he's not saying how he'll vote is one, because either he votes against the abortion referendum and looks like a loser.
Yes.
Which he hates looking like a loser, or he votes for it and he loses some of his Christian nationalists. Right. So, but the other thing is, Kamala already changes the outlook in Florida. Is it enough to win that Senate race? Probably not, but yeah. You don't know what's going to happen.
Nope.
You don't know what's going to happen.
Right. And with abortion on the ballot there, that could, although the Senate candidate they have is just weak, Debbie Mercosell Powell, who couldn't even win re-election to the House.
Re-election, yeah. But you know, if you can convert, that's going to win with, right now it's polling at 67%. So if you can convert most of those people by saying, and this is why Donald Trump is trying to downplay the import of abortion. If you can say to them, Donald Trump not only will nationalize abortion, but he also wants to get rid of birth control.
Right.
Which is true, by the way.
Yeah.
You know, if you can convert those numbers through some miracle, I agree that they don't have a great, I mean, like they have a better chance of winning the Texas race against Colin Allred than they do. Yeah.
Right. Colin Allred against Ted Cruz. Yeah, which would be great. You know, there's so much up in the air. But Florida and Arizona both have an abortion mandate, a directive on the ballot, which should help boost votes for the Democrats.
And in Arizona, you know, the important, like, again, Gallego looks like he'll win handily. But the important thing in Arizona are all of these electoral positions where absolute nutbags just won the primary last week. And so if you can put those in the hands of Democrats, particularly Maricopa, that's incredibly important for 2 years down the road.
Yes. Yeah. So much is up in the air. It'll be interesting to see what happens today. Again, the rally, I don't know what time it begins. They haven't told us that yet, but I've got to be there. You know, doors close apparently at 3:30. Local time. So yeah, we'll see. You know, one other thing that I want to hit on is we're talking about Tim Walz, and his story is just incredible. Everything from his National Guard service to being a high school teacher to being the faculty advisor for the LGBTQ alliance. Just everything about, I get goosebumps thinking about his story. Well, J.D. Vance and the Trump campaign are pushing this stolen valor bullshit. Here's J.D. Vance on this.
Well, I wonder, Tim Walz, when were you ever in war? When was this, what was this weapon that you carried into war, given that you abandoned your unit right before they went to Iraq, and what? He has not spent a day in a combat zone? What bothers me about Tim Walz is the stolen valor garbage. Do not pretend to be something that you're not. And if he wants to criticize me for getting an Ivy League education, I'm proud of the fact that my mamaw supported me, that I was able to make something of myself. I'd be ashamed if I was him and I lied about my military service like he did.
He lied about nothing. He was in the National Guard for 24 years. He trained soldiers. And when he left to, I guess, go into teaching, it was 10 months before the deployment.
No,
wasn't
he,
it?
What happened was in 2005, by February, he had decided he was going to run for Congress.
Oh, okay.
He's a Wellstone action guy, by the way. So,
of course he is,
which is super cool. But if people know anything about Wellstone action or Paul Wellstone, David Korn has a really cool piece on how he first got involved in politics through Wellstone action. Wow. I really recommend that. But so in February of 2005, he decided he was going to run. In March of 2005, there was an announcement that guardsmen and women were going to be deployed in Iraq. And so he, at that point, learned it was a possibility. He put out a press release. He said, I'm still going to run. He made it clear in March of 2005 that he was still going to run. He retired in May of 2005. And one of the reasons he retired is because, well, you can run for office and be in the Guard. He was concerned about Hatch Act violations. He was concerned that it would make it more problematic to run as a Democrat while he was serving in the Guard. And then, so he retired in May of 2005, and the actual call up for his battalion wasn't until July of 2005. So you literally need a time machine for J.D. Vance's primary attack on him to be true.
Right.
There's another one that he's doing, which is that more recently at an event on gun control, Walz was just trying to make the point, like, these weapons are for war. They're not right. for, they're not for kids. Right.
Yes.
Because one of the things Walz's daughter, Hope, had gone to him and said, Dad, you're one of the few people who can actually do something about gun control. And he's right. actually, you know, he had a 100% NRA rating when he was in Congress. He's moved left in that as he's become a governor, but also as you continue to have these mass killings in schools. And so at an event where he was trying to explain the logic of imposing some controls on guns, he basically said, why would this weapon that I carried in war, and that's, I think, right. close to the actual quote. Why would I bring, you know, this weapon of war isn't meant, you don't need it. Right.
Right.
And that was the point. And so it was inartful. Like, if you take it out of context, but he did, like, J.D. Vance is like, well, you never deployed for war. In fact, he served in Italy for, I don't know, 7 months to support Operation Enduring Freedom, the mm-hmm. Afghan war.
Mm-hmm.
Because they were taking people who were already stationed in these bases and moving them overseas. So they were basically protecting bases left open because people were deploying to Afghanistan. And did he have a weapon there? Yeah. Is Italy a war zone? No. Kamala's campaign, she was asked about this before she got on the plane yesterday. And she was like, look, I don't think you should criticize anybody's
service
or serving.
That's right.
And she's taking a very high road on that. They did tweak his bio, Walz's bio on the campaign website, you know, but, like, it's still insane that they picked Walz on Tuesday and had him practicing, because he's never used a teleprompter. They had him practicing on the teleprompter all day Tuesday and then have this big event in Philadelphia at the end of the day. So you're going to have some errors like that, because somebody who's not checking with Walz is going to lift something that was, you know, the one other thing that they're pushing is that he was, before he retired, the senior most non-commissioned officer
in the House
in Southern Minnesota.
Oh, okay.
And the senior most non-commissioned officer in Congress.
Right.
And then when he retired, because of how long he had been in that position, he didn't get benefits of that role.
Right.
Right. So he was diverted back to what he had been before his most recent promotion. He didn't finish all the training. But it's a benefits issue. It's not a, did you ever get promoted to that
right.
level? And so another of the complaints they're making is that he didn't really have that. Now, the Wall Street Journal has come out against this attack.
Yes.
Editorial page. And so you're seeing far more pushback than you saw on the Stolen Valor stuff. And you're seeing it from different places like Wall Street Journal.
Yes.
And I think you're still going to have the feverish swamps of Trump supporters who are opposed to it. And it is designed to make it harder for Tim Walz to go into VFW posts and say, please come out and vote for me. But the guy, you know, he's faced this attack before. And ultimately what you have is you have J.D. Vance, who served for 4 years
right.
dictating that Tim Walz should have served for 27
right.
years
and
instead
of
24.
And he was like a PR guy. He wasn't out on the battlefield either. He was writing press
right.
releases.
But, yeah, I mean,
right?
but the premise and the ethic that Kamala is adopting is you honor him for his service too.
That's right.
You know, the Marines thought that J.D. Vance was best deployed as a propagandist.
Right.
And guess what? You know, like, I did a post and I was like, what did each of them learn from their service? J.D. Vance learned how to be a propagandist and
right.
he's good at that. Mm-hmm. And Tim Walz learned leadership and he's good at that. And you know what? I'd rather have Tim Walz on my ticket than I would J.D. Vance.
Absolutely.
Because J.D. Vance isn't all that good at propaganda. His propaganda kind of falls flat. And the one other thing it's worth knowing is that Walz retired in 2020 with 20 years of service. And mm-hmm. then after 9/11, he reenlisted.
Oh, wow.
And so Walz actually, you know, like, if he was really making decisions based on not wanting to fight a war on terror, he wouldn't have reenlisted. He got those 4 extra years because he reenlisted after 9/11 to serve his country. And so,
I mean, 2000, you know, again, not 2020. in 2000, and then in 2001 after 9/11 re-enlisted.
Joined back. So he was a teacher during that period.
Gotcha.
Right? The period where J.D. Vance is complaining he didn't stay in. He was a teacher. He had, hope was for. He had served for 24 years already. He had lost a significant part of his hearing. Speaking of people who couldn't hear, he had to have his hearing surgically fixed after he retired. And this is what, this is what Donald Trump wants to make. And, it could go either way. But one way it could go is that a lot of people are going to be offended by the attack altogether because, the people in Congress, including Republicans, are like, look, this guy, this is the other thing I pointed out is that J.D. Vance has done nothing for the military in the Senate. Instead, he, because he wants to vote for Russia, because he is so committed to the Russian stance of not funding Ukraine, he has voted against raises for the military. He has voted against funding for the military. Whereas Walz's history, like Walz was the first generation of anti-war veteran.
Mm-hmm.
And he tried to, I forget whether it was 90 days or 60 days, but he committed when he was running. He was like, I'm going to try and end the war. I'm going to try to bring troops back from Iraq within 90 days.
Wow.
He tried, it failed. But at the same time, he also spent his 12 years in Congress making sure that veterans got the support they needed for PTSD, for suicide, raises, don't ask, don't tell. And so he was really firmly committed to making life better for people both in active duty and who had retired. And that's the opposite of what J.D. Vance. So, that's one way I think that you could see this go is that what Walz did when he was in Congress was really serve the men and women who have joined the armed services.
Right.
And J.D. Vance has done none of that because he's too busy trying to help Putin.
Well, it's the contrast between the two of them is apparent, and how the fact that they're grasping at this and again, the stolen valor thing, it's bringing up a lot of bad memories of when they swift boated John Kerry. And there's a picture I'm just putting up on the screen from the convention, the Republican convention back in 2004, where they were all wearing, purple heart bandages as a way of mocking him,
And it's important to remember Chris Lacivita was the guy in charge of the Stolen Valor movement back in 2004. Mm-hmm. Chris Lacivita is the guy who smeared John Kerry, and it was very effective back then. But Chris Lacivita is one of Trump's two campaign managers right now. He's one of the people who is not getting through to Trump that he's not winning in the polls anymore. that Kamala's crowds, if we're going to measure, if we're going to measure success based on crowds, Kamala's doing better than Donald Trump is doing. Kamala has the excitement that Donald Trump believes only he has. And so is Chris Lacivita too busy smearing Tim Walz to level with Donald Trump? I don't know. But, there's increasing conversations about whether Trump needs to mix up his campaign team. And remember, there's always these backbiters, people like I'm sure Roger Stone is undermining Trump's campaign managers.
Oh, I'm sure.
I wouldn't be surprised if Corey Lewandowski,
and
this
Kellyanne
is how
Conway, and she just went to work for China? Who did she?
No, Pinchuk, Ukrainian oligarch who has been Pinchuk was the cover that Manafort used for the report he did, the Skadden-Arps report he did to try and whitewash his prosecution of Yulia Tymoshenko.
Okay.
So Pinchuk is the guy who paid for that. They wanted to have somebody who wasn't obviously in the tank for Russia. He's paying Conway $50,000 a month.
Lovely. Okay. So there's that. All right. We're already over.
Oh, and two other details that are of interest. Andy Ogles, who is Tennessee's version of George Santos.
Okay.
His phone was seized this week by the FBI. So he's under active investigation for basically the same garbage that George Santos did, which was lie about his background.
Oh, my.
And then Scott Ritter, his entire house was searched this week. by the FBI as a foreign agent, presumably of Russia. And it happened the day after he met with Robert Kennedy Jr.
Oh, interesting.
It happened before he met with the Russian ambassador. And so so that's another interesting thing that's, you know, that's burbling along.
Interesting. Scott Ritter, by the way, and tell me if I'm thinking the right guy. I think I am. He was a weapons inspector who then years later was like busted with child pornography on his computer, right?
Twice.
Yeah. Twice. Lovely. And yet people kept throwing his name out. I'm like, do you know who you, it is you're quoting here? Not a good guy. So, okay, interesting that he's now coming around again. One other thing that I wanted to ask you about is, Tanya, Judge Chutkin has the documents case back, despite Donald Trump saying, I won the case, right?
Well, Trump was talking about the other case, the Aileen Cannon. Yeah, okay, and he even Cannon. Said Aileen Cannon is brilliant. Yes, brilliant. So she brilliant sure judge. Is going to get a Supreme
I'm
Court nomination if she's going to get Alito's seat.
But this is a Jan. 6 case.
Chutkin got it back. The next day she said, I want a status report by the 9th, by yesterday. By today. And Jack Smith said, no, I want until the end of the month. I want until August 30th.
What's that about?
Now, I wrote a post, and the post argues that the most obvious explanation for that is that Jack Smith has to consult with all of the people who were dealing with the aftermath. It's not necessarily just about the immunity ruling. It's also about the obstruction ruling. Because remember, the Supreme Court also sharply narrowed the way in which you can apply obstruction to January 6th.
Yes.
And so it is absolutely clear that they have to figure out how they're going to do that, both with Trump and with a bunch of the crime scene people. So that's one thing that they're definitely doing is how much of what we've charged against Trump can we still use in the obstruction context? But because they used the date August 30th, that would be the last date. That's a Friday. Yesterday was a Thursday. Today's a Friday. We always meet on Friday, right?
Like, yes, we do.
Because they are asking for the extension to the 30th, that would be the last day the DOJ would allow anyone to prosecute, to indict somebody who is at all politically connected. So it opens the possibility that they're going to supersede either, and some other smart lawyers are arguing this, either by adding all of his co-conspirators, or, and this is my, like, I'll leave it here and you can go to your rally. One thing that is permitted by the three rulings, by the immunity ruling, by the obstruction ruling, and by the ruling that says he couldn't be excluded under the 14th Amendment, that ruling said specifically the insurrection, the law prohibiting insurrection is still on the books.
Okay.
The immunity ruling says you can indict somebody for a crime that they have been acquitted in impeachment on. Trump was acquitted on insurrection charges.
Right.
And there were people, and I was one of them, that said one of the reasons Jack Smith maybe didn't charge insurrection is because it would open up the possibility that Trump would say, oh, I was acquitted, you can't charge me with that.
Right.
In his opinion, John Roberts said that being acquitted in impeachment does not exclude being charged for the same charge criminally.
Right. Oh, interesting.
So the 14th Amendment one, they said, no, there's already a law on the book that you can use to exclude somebody, and that's insurrection. The immunity one, the obstruction one, I think it still works against Donald Trump because of the fake electors, but you may not be able to get the thing I described to you in, which is that he sent 10,000 people, 20,000 people to the Capitol.
Right.
And just take my word for it, that there are parts of the case that are not official actions, but that nevertheless might be excluded depending on how you read the obstruction ruling to apply to Donald Trump. There are other ways you might get it in, but nevertheless, take my word for that. And then third, as I said, John Roberts explicitly said, in his opinion, six people joined in the opinion that acquittal in impeachment does not prohibit you being charged criminally for that same charge. So This is, I mean, as I said, the most likely reading is that they need to coordinate with everybody else on the obstruction ruling. But one way outside possibility is that they're going to supersede Donald Trump with insurrection, which would disqualify him if they charged him and convicted him by January.
Yes.
Then it would disqualify him from holding office as president.
As it should. And I don't know where it is, but there's a clip of Donald Trump saying, can you imagine a presidential candidate under criminal indictment? It can't be. He was, of course, talking about Hillary Clinton, mm-hmm. which she wasn't, but hello, here we are.
It's possible that it's most likely that that's not actually happening. So I want to warn people that this is the outside possibility. It's most likely that's not happening. It's also quite possible that if it is happening, it won't happen. That somebody at DOJ will say, no, we don't really want to go there. But we are having a delay, and the delay actually could be sort of interesting. We could see charges against Rudy. We could see charges against Roger Stone. We could see charges. So, yes, we weren't going to get a prosecution by the election in any case. And these days might make things more interesting.
Oh, most definitely. And it's still, we're talking about the immediate future. It'll be by the end of the month. Instead of today, it'll be within the next 3 weeks.
Correct.
Right. Okay. Well, something else to look forward to. I'm looking forward to this rally. So I'm going to go. I'll post pictures and video or whatever I can get. I'm still on Shitter. I'm at Nicole Sandler. On Threads and Blue Sky, and I'll try to put stuff over the weekend as well on the website at NicoleSandler.com. In the meantime, Marcy Wheeler, always a pleasure, and we'll do it again next week. Thank you so much.
Have fun at the rally.
I plan on it. Marcy Wheeler, find her at Emptywheel.net, and do check out Ball of Thread, the other podcast, the one with LOL GOP, because it's also brilliant. I'll talk to you next week. Thanks. Have a great weekend.
Have a good weekend.
You too. Peace out, everyone.